Welcome, everyone, and good afternoon. Today, we will have the honor to welcome among us Professor Ioannis Economou. Professor Economou holds a diploma in chemical engineering from National Technical University of Athens and a PhD also in chemical engineering from the Johns Hopkins University of Baltimore, US. He currently works as a professor of chemical engineering and associate dean for academic affairs at the Texas A&M University of Qatar. Professor Economou's research interests are related to the development and validation of multi-scale thermodynamics models for the oil and gas, chemical, and pharmaceutical industry. In recent years, he developed models for CO2 capture, transportation, and sequestration technology, shale gas technology, ecosystems, green solvents, pharmaceuticals, and soft materials, including polymers, ionic liquids, and metal organic frameworks. He has published over 210 research papers in leading journals in chemical engineering, physical chemistry, and polymer science. In addition, he co-authored 10 book chapters and co-edited one book entitled Natural Gas Processing from Midstream to Downstream. So once again, welcome Professor Economou. Thanks so much for being here, and please feel free to start the presentation.
Thank you very much for the very nice introduction. And can you all hear me and see my first slide? Good.
Yes.
Yes, very well.
Let me start by thanking Professor Tavares and his group for giving me the opportunity to be here today. And I would like to point out that one of the very few good things of the pandemic is this seminar series that our friend Fred started last May or June. So it started as, I guess, an experiment, and it became a tradition worldwide. So I have attended several talks from distinguished speakers. Several of them are here today, good friends of mine like Thanos and Yorgos and other people. And so it's a great opportunity to be here with all of you today. And I would like to give an overview of a few things that we do in my group. I put a little bit of a general title, Molecular Engineering for Environment-Friendly Industrial Processes and Materials Design. I will present a couple of projects that have been done both in Texas and at Qatar, and also at the National Center for Scientific Research in Athens, where I have been working since 1995, but I have been away now for almost a decade. And before I start, I would like to acknowledge work done by Panagiotis Krokidas. He was and still is a postdoc in my group. And Kostas Papavasiliou and Lukas Paristeras, also in my group in Demokritos. And of course, I have been collaborating for many, many years with a good friend, Marcelo Castier. He was before in Federal University of Rio. Now he's in Paraguay. And then Ed Brothers and Salva Monzo, they are physical chemists doing quantum mechanics simulations for us. As I said, I'm in Texas and I'm at Qatar. Qatar is a small country in the Arabian Gulf or Persian Gulf, whatever you want to call it, it's the same thing. It's a small country. It has a population of 2.7 million people, but for chemical engineers and engineering in general, it's an important country because it produces a lot of natural gas. In fact, we have the largest natural gas field in the world. It's called the North Field, that it's shared between Iran and Qatar. So for engineering and science is a very important part of the world. Now, and even more important is the initiative that the government of Qatar has introduced in the mid 90s. Now we're a little bit over, I mean, we're getting close to 30 years. Qatar Foundation was established as a major initiative to bring together universities, research centers, museums, and a lot of other activities related to science, technology, and culture. And one of the major initiatives was the establishment of the Education City that brought together a number of international universities, mostly American universities. So you can see here the number of the name of the university that we are in, we have in Education City. Each one of these universities came with a different college. And we are all together on the same campus. So we are, Texas A&M came with the engineering college, Weill Cornell is medicine, Carnegie Mellon came with the business school, Georgetown with public political science and foreign diplomacy, Northwestern is journalism, and Virginia Commonwealth is fine arts. We have a business school from Paris, the Haute École de Commerce of Paris, UCL brought archaeology, and then we have a local university, which is the Hamad bin Khalifa University. This is a beautiful experiment because it allows us to work together, teach courses, different courses. So, for example, a student from Texas A&M can take a political science course at Georgetown. And we're going now to the next phase, which will be to integrate some of the programs and offer joint programs. And we call this multiversity. And I spent a lot of time, a little bit more time on this because I'm in charge of this from the Texas A&M side. So we're trying to bring together people from different campuses with different backgrounds to work together toward joint degrees. We'll see how it goes. So as I said, we're Texas A&M. We have been there now for close to 20 years. We're almost close to complete the agreement for the next decade. We started with just 30 students. Today we have around 700 students in four engineering disciplines: chemical, electrical, mechanical, and petroleum engineering. We have graduated as of last week, approximately 1,200 students, most of them at the bachelor level. We have one master program, but we have very strong research activity, mostly by postdocs, research scientists, and also we have a number of PhD students coming from College Station, Texas, to Qatar to do research. So this is a beautiful initiative that is going on and is developing now, as I said, for almost 20 years. Now, let me go on and get into my actual part of my talk that has to do with, as I said, molecular engineering. And I'm a chemical engineer, and I believe the majority of people in this seminar today are chemical engineers. So we know that the major activity of our profession is to design and optimize processes and materials. And we do this in many different ways. You can do experimental work, but over the last 20 years, there has been an increasing activity towards developing computational methods. So I would call this hierarchical multi-scale approach. So essentially, we're doing calculations at different length and time scales in order to be able to design and optimize processes that have maximum performance with respect to some specific metrics. When I was a student 30 years ago, a lot of work was done at this level, at the macroscopic thermodynamic level. But then, thanks to the tremendous developments in statistical mechanics and molecular simulation, today chemical engineers do a lot of work at a much elementary level, at a much lower scale. We do molecular simulations, we do quantum mechanics. And the main idea is how to combine and how to connect information generated from one level to the other. And we have my group, both in Democritus and in Texas A&M, we're trying to do work at different scales. So essentially at the lower scale, we try to develop methods to improve the understanding of how the material and the fluid works at the molecular mesoscopic level. At the upper scale of the diagram, we try to improve the process design and optimization. And again, my group works on various projects at these levels here, which I have highlighted with red. I have chosen to spoke about a few projects that have immediate industrial importance and interest. And of course, one of the major activity where we work as chemical engineers has to do with separation processes. There has been a very nice paper by Dave Scholl and Lively from Georgia Tech a few years ago in Nature that has attracted a lot of attention. So essentially these people, they said that we are spending a lot of energy. So this is the US energy consumption, almost 100 quads. This is a huge amount of energy. And they said that we spent a lot of energy at the industrial sector, almost 32%, and we can reduce significantly energy by going from thermal processes to membrane separations. So we can develop separation membrane separation methods that will consume less energy and will be much more efficient. And Scholl and Lively, they defined a number of chemical separations which are extremely important for industry in general. And if you look them here, I believe that many of you, if not all of you, have been involved one way or the other with some of these separations. For example, we separate hydrocarbon from crude oil. This is one of the most traditional areas of chemical engineering. Today, we spent a lot of effort on greenhouse gas separation from dilute emissions. Alkenes from alkanes is a huge industry, spends a huge amount of energy on this, and so on and so forth. So this is an area where there is it's very active area of research in chemical engineering. So if I focus a little bit on a couple of them, so in industry we are maybe 50% of the energy is consumed in separation processes, and there has been a number of important separations which I list them here. As I said, today CO2 control is one of the major problems that we face, and there is a lot of effort to separate or to capture CO2 in situ during production, so we can capture CO2 from flue gas, from fossil fuels. We have a number of techniques for CO2 hydrogen separation, for natural gas reforming. And if you can use membranes, we can significantly reduce CO2. At the same time, another very important separation process has to do with paraffin olefin separation. This is also another very classical type of separation in chemical industry. For example, ethylene ethane and propylene ethane. In industry, we spend a lot of energy on this, and there is significant need to reduce the amount of energy for this kind of separation. And again, membrane is a promising technology, a promising alternative technology to distillation and other techniques. So when it comes to these materials, we have a number of traditional and less traditional materials for gas separation. So I have a schematic representation of the various materials. Zeolites have been used for quite some time for different kinds of separations. Carbon nanotubes, for example, may be used for this kind of separations. And over the last 15 years, we have the so-called metal organic frameworks, MOFs, which have been introduced by physical chemists, and they have attracted lots of attention for gas separation. So why MOFs or ZIF, zeolitic imidazolate frameworks? In terms of chemistry, they can be relatively quickly synthesized without not much of effort. The important thing is that they provide framework flexibility, so we can have different structural characteristics depending on the separation that we're interested in. We can develop with MOFs ultra microporous membranes. So the window size, the aperture is in the order of a few angstrom, which is extremely appropriate for small gas separation. And even more important, we can tailor-made some of these MOF structures in order to improve the separation efficiency for a given gas mixture. Let me remind you how we the basic mechanism based on which you can separate materials using you can separate gases using microporous materials. And essentially, we have two different approaches. One is the so-called kinetic or size-based selectivity. So essentially, this is a schematic representation of a cage. This you may consider this as an elemental cage for a zeolite or a MOF. You want to separate a gas mixture of large and small molecules, and essentially the bottleneck is here. So essentially, this is kinetic-driven separation. The smaller molecule will diffuse faster through the bottleneck, so you can achieve separation based on size selectivity. Another approach has to do with the affinity between the gases and the wall. here you may have the case where you have the small molecules, the blue molecules, adsorb preferentially on the walls of the of your morph or of your membrane in general, and you have the so-called adsorption-based selectivity. So these are the two based methods based on which we separate mixtures. And the main physicochemical property is the so-called permeability, which is the product of the diffusivity of component I times the solubility of the same component. And if you have a mixture of I and J, then you can define the, the selectivity alpha ij, which is the ratio of the two permeabilities. So essentially, if you want to have an optimum separation, you would like to maximize the alpha ij, and then you will recover I over component J. Now, as I said, diffusivity is one of the most important, one of the two important properties of interest here. And let me show you some typical diffusivities that you may experience when you try to separate different gases using ZIF-8. ZIF-8 is probably the most well-studied ZIF. This is the aperture here. So this is the essentially the molecules, the gas molecules, they have to diffuse through this opening. And you can see here the diffusivity versus the penetrant size. And these are data from the literature. This originally was proposed by the group of Bill Koros, and we have added a few more molecules. So essentially, the interesting area for the gas separation is this gray band here, which essentially will allow us to separate mixtures of gases, which are in this gray zone. To the left, the diffusivity is very large, so molecules will diffuse fast. To the right, the molecules are large and the diffusivity will go down. And the question is, okay, if we would like to separate a mixture of gases that are not within this gray zone, what do we do? And you can do, this is where we come in. So we have tried to design methods to modify, in this case, to decrease the ZIF aperture. And you can do it in two different ways. So this is the elemental structure of my ZIF-8. So M here means a metal atom. This is a carbon. And essentially, you can do a number of things. You can you can use a different metal here. So you can tighten the hinge by replacing the metal with someone with another metal with a shorter ionic radius. Or I can put a bulky substitute here in order to reduce the aperture size. And the way that this works is that this is flexible, which means that it works like a saloon door. So depending on the strength or the stiffness of the door, someone may easily go through or not. And I will show you also in a minute how this works during a simulation. As I said, our work is computational. So essentially, you need to develop an appropriate force field to describe, of course, the morph structure. And we do this by combining density functional theory calculations with molecular simulation. In our case, our base was the Ampere force field. So we take from Ampere, this is a typical Ampere force field representation. We have Lennard-Jones interactions. Of course, the basic structure of the morph is charged. So we need to calculate the charges. We need to calculate the stiffness of the bonds and the stiffness of the bond angles and the torsional angle. So whatever I have here in red is calculated from density functional theory calculations. And once we do this, we're able to reproduce the morph structure at the molecular level. So we get everything right. We get the bond angle, the bond length, the bond angles, the aperture. We compare to experimental data and we get indeed very good agreement. And then when we go to the physical property calculations, as I said, my two main properties of interest is solubility. You can do this, for example, using Widom particle insertion methodology. It's a Monte Carlo method, very well defined, very well used in the literature. Or you can use molecular dynamic simulations to calculate diffusivity. Things get a little bit more tricky when the diffusivity gets low. And in this case, we have used transition state theory, umbrella sampling, and other techniques to calculate the diffusivities. And as I said, my ultimate goal is to design ZIFs that will be appropriate for a particular kind of gas separation. So again, this is my ZIF-8. I can go from zinc, from metal to ZIF-67. In ZIF-67 now I have cobalt. So green is a cobalt. I can use another metal, beryllium, or I can use a different substitute here. So I can use a bulkier linkage to reduce the aperture size. By doing this, I tighter the bond and I reduce the aperture. So I go from 3.44 to something like 2.3 aperture size. And indeed, by doing this, we have been able to develop membranes that can very efficiently separate gas mixtures. Before I go to this, let me show you how this works. Remember, I had a cartoon about the saloon doors, and indeed, this is how it works here. So this is this video is from molecular dynamic simulations, and essentially, I have flexibility in my aperture, and this allows the gas molecules to go through. So we get a very good understanding of the response of the aperture to the diffusion of gas molecules. So based on this, we have been able to calculate a broad range of gas separations. I will only show you a couple of examples. This is one of them. This is CO2 with methane. Remember, this is one of the most important gas separations, especially if we want to recover CO2 in situ. This is my separation factor versus the permeability of the fast diffusing one. This is a very well-known plot proposed by Robson 30 years ago. Robson was an engineer in early kid, and he showed this kind of graphs for many different kind of mixed gas separations. The important thing is that the separation factor changes inversely proportional to permeability. So as the permeability goes up, the separation factor goes down. And you can realize that essentially what you are interested in is that you want highest permeability and high separation factor. So you need maximum throughput for maximum separation. I have a number of data points here. These blue points are polymeric membranes. The red points is MOF from the literature. And this green points is ZIFs from this work. And this pink area here is what people call commercially attractive region. This has been defined using some important metrics by Bill Koros and co-workers at Georgia Tech. So you can see I go from ZIF 8 here to ZIF 67. This is my cobalt ZIF to beryllium way up and to ZIF 7-8. ZIF 7-8 is a hybrid of ZIF 8 with ZIF 7. So huge, significant improvement as we go by changing the metal. This is for CO2 methane, and this is a different example. This is oxygen nitrogen, also a very, very important separation, of course, for medical application. We're interested, for example, for oxygen enrichment. ZIF-8 is down here. ZIF-67 is closer to that. But then you can see, again, the improvement we get with the cobalt ZIF-7-8, beryllium ZIF, and ZIF-7-8. When I saw these calculations, I got very excited. And then when we try start looking at in the literature to see whether we can synthesize this MOF here, the results, what we find out was not very, interesting, because we realized that beryllium is extremely toxic. So we talked with a number of people around the world synthesizing these MOFs. Nobody wanted to synthesize the beryllium ZIF, but at least we know that with the simulation, we can design some good membrane. So we're still working on this, and now we have moved to the next phase where we're doing massive production of results using different metals. So this is the work that we have been doing on kinetic-driven separation. Let me talk a little bit about the adsorption-based selectivity. Here, the basic mechanism is the interaction of the wall with one of the two gases. And what we have done in this work is that we have combined ZIFs with ionic liquid. So essentially, we take the ZIF structure and we put in there ionic liquids. Ionic liquids is very promising chemicals that are environment friendly and are used or are proposed to use widely in very chemistry applications. The one of the most highly studied is this butyl methylimidazolium with TF2N. And we had some experimental data from the literature on this. So you take the ionic liquid into the ZIF-8, and then when we compare to for different gas separations, what we have seen was the following. So CO2 methane, again, is one of the separations. These are experimental data from the literature, 7.5. We get 7.4, excellent agreement. But also when you put ionic liquid into the ZIF, experimentally it goes to 41, simulation it's 42, excellent agreement. And also similarly for CO2 nitrogen, we go from something like 20 or 10 from simulation to a fivefold increase when we add ionic liquid into the ZIF. This is a very nice, promising combination of MOFs with ionic liquids. This has experimental data have been on a particular composition, which is 23.5 molar ratio of ionic liquid into ZIF. And of course, with molecular simulation, we have extended this work doing two things. First of all, we look at different ionic liquids. So essentially, we kept the cation the same and we looked at different anions, but also we played with the composition. So this is again my two separations, CO2 with nitrogen. This is the adsorption selectivity versus the composition ionic liquid weight fraction for the three different anions, the same cation, three different anions. And one can appreciate the fact that we have an optimum composition, optimum amount of ionic liquid, which gives a maximum selectivity for this particular mixture. And on the right, again, it's a different separation, CO2 with methane. Again, we have an optimum composition of something like 25% of ionic liquid that gives a maximum selectivity. And then once you put more ionic liquid, we have a significant decrease in the selectivity. And this is probably because the whole system becomes very crowded. So then the interactions become very different and the selectivity goes down. This has been the first part of my my talk, and I would like to switch gears and talk about something which has to do with the petrochemical industry, and also this is driven by Qatar abundance of natural gas. We have the so-called G12 process. G12 stands for gas to liquid. So essentially, you get methane, and through a Fischer-Tropsch process, a catalytic process, you produce heavy hydrocarbons. This process has been around for almost a century now. Actually, it was proposed by Fischer-Tropsch in 1922, but it has received renowned interest by the oil industry, initially by Sasol in South Africa, and later on by Shell, Exxon, and others. Today, we have the largest G12 plant in Qatar. This is in the so-called G12 Pearl. This is in Ras Laffan. It's 75 kilometers northeast of Doha. And the plant of Shell operates approximately 140,000 barrels of oil equivalent per day. So this is a catalytic process again. It takes place at this temperature rates, 180 to 270 degrees C, and pressure in the order of 20 to 80 bar. As I said, it's a catalytic process. This is the main reaction. You produce heavy hydrocarbons, large hydrocarbons. And the when it comes to the design and the optimization of the process, of course, the design engineers would like to know what is the diffusivity of the reactants and then of the products in the catalyst pore. And of course, you have the catalytic reaction, and then you have the diffusion back to the bulk. So this is a project that we initiated more than 10 years ago, and I will only show you some of the highlights of this. And essentially, I will try to convince you that with molecular simulation, we can develop some very interesting results. So, of course, again, the very important question is, what is the diffusivity of gases in these G12 hydrocarbons? And when we started this, again, in the early 2010, we looked around for the diffusivity of the gases. Remember, the important gases here is hydrogen, carbon monoxide, and water. This is the diffusivity, the diffusion coefficient as a function of the carbon number. Again, the G12 process produces hydrocarbons from something like hexane or octane or the way to C100. There have been very, very little experimental information. These are the open points, and the field points is what we get out of molecular dynamic simulations. The agreement has been very good for all three different hydrocarbons. And at that point, it was around 2012 or 13, we started a collaboration with an experimental group, one of the top experimental groups in Europe, in the Technical University of Erlangen, where they have a very sophisticated list of optical methods. They designed and they built the light scattering apparatus, high pressure and high temperature, to simulate exactly the conditions of the G12 process. This is the cell, the high pressure, high temperature cell. And we generated a number of experimental data, lots of experimental data. And I'm only showing just a few of them here. Again, this is collaboration with Erlangen, where we look at the mutual diffusivity in C28. Octacosane was used as a representative hydrocarbon from the G12 process. So what we have here, we have data from dynamic light scattering, molecular simulation, and a different method. And the agreement has been more or less pretty good, both for carbon monoxide, hydrogen, and water. And these were preliminary data, again, for simulations in the bulk. And then the next question came, which is, how do the system behave when you put it in confinement? And the confinement is my nanopore. Okay. So this is the system. And I will, at this point, we picked a prototype system, which was C28 with water. C28 represented the heavy wax. And we put the mixture in confinement in titanium dioxide. Titanium dioxide is one of the most widely used substrate for this kind of application. And you can see that during the time that I was talking, we see a very clear phase separation. So the red molecules is water, which preferentially adsorbs on the titanium surface, and the blue change is C28. So we get the two phase separation, very clear, well defined. But even more important is that we have been able to calculate the diffusivity at different layers, which is something very, very difficult to measure experimentally. So, and these are some results. Obviously, when we are, this is the bulk of C28, and for water, obviously, the C28, it's diffuses less fast than water, but we can see here that the diffusivity of water changes dramatically from, this is the bulk, down here is the bulk, changes dramatically from close to the to the wall, so essentially it's immobile, to in the center the diffusivity gets very, very close to what we observed in the bulk. And of course C28 is mostly here in the bulk, and the diffusivity, this is the diffusivity inside the center of the pore, it's very close to what we have seen in the bulk. Very, very nice. And then after we saw this, the next question is, what is going to happen when we're going to get closer to a real nanopore size? And what we have decided at that point is to go and perform simulation at a more higher level using coarse-grained models, coarse-grained force fields. And in this case, we chose the so-called Martini force field. This is one of the most popular force fields in the literature. And the idea here is that you go and you map heavy atoms into one bit. And in Martini, they use the so-called 4-to-1 mapping. So four heavy atoms, four carbons are represented by one bit. And this has been done extensively for different, mostly biomolecules. Martini has been developed in Groningen mostly for biomolecules. And you can see here different representation. The atomistic is shown here, and then the Martini representation over there. And again, my focus is on hydrocarbon representation. Okay. And before I do this, I will also go and show you some more real life waxes from an actual G12 process. This is a model that was given to us, a real wax given to us by Shell. This is the composition representation. You see, we have a broad range of molecules from, you can see here also the actual representation from C20 or to C60. This is the simulation, this is the experimental data. We represent it very accurately and very faithfully, the actual experimental data to simulation. And this shows some typical results for the density, the surface tension, and the viscosity of the mixture. And we have here a number of different calculations with different force fields. TRAP, United Atom, this is the most typical force field we use for hydrocarbon. TRAP stands for Transfer Potential for Phase Equilibria, developed by Ilya Sipan and his group. OPLS is another very well-known force field in the literature for different chemicals. LOPLS starts for a modification for the linear hydrocarbons, developed in Erlangen, and then the Martini. And what we have seen is the main message is that Martini represents pretty well these properties for density, surface tension, and viscosity for this wax. And even more importantly, we could do significantly longer simulation. So some typical results are shown here. With LOPLS, we can simulate 20 nanoseconds per day. With Martini, we can go almost to a microsecond simulation per day. Significant improvement. So based on this, we move to the next level and we start to generate massively calculations for different systems in different confinements. So now we went from titanium dioxide to graphene. On the left is my all-atom model, on the right is my coarse grain model. And I mean, you can easily visualize that what we get from the all-atom is very similar to what we get in the coarse grain model. This is the density representation. Again, my wall is graphene, is hydrophobic. So the C28 goes and aligns very close to the graphene wall. Water is in the middle. The density profile is very similar in both cases. We also looked at the effect of changing the nanopore wall. So we go from graphene to graphene oxide. And here we get the exact opposite behavior. So now the water goes and aligns very close to the wall, to the graphene oxide, which is hydrophilic, and C28 is in the middle. And then we went to the next phase, and based on experimental data that we got from Shell and from the literature, there is evidence that we have production of oxygenates in terms of methanol and ethanol in this process. We look at methanol and ethanol a few years back. The most recent work focused on dodecanol. And again, we went and we modeled dodecanol using the Martini force field. So based on the 4-to-1 representation, dodecanol is reproduced by 3 beads. This is the yellow molecule here. And you can see that dodecanol prefers to be at the interface. And of course, this is not surprising. So this is what we get in the graphene, and this is what we get in graphene oxide. This is dodecanol. And essentially, it aligns, it positions itself at the interface between the aqueous phase and the hydrocarbon phase. Okay. And of course, the ultimate goal here was to calculate the diffusivity. And this is, I understand, this is a pretty busy slide. So I will only provide the highlights. This is diffusivities for water and C28. The left two sets of graphs refer to simulation from the all-atom representation, and the two right ones is the coarse grain representation. So this is mostly TRAP with water, and this is Martini. In each case, I have graphene and graphene oxide's wall, graphene and graphite oxide, and then I have a number of regions. So region one is close to the pore surface, region two is more to the bulk, and the thick band is the diffusion coefficient in the bulk. So for example, here I have bulk diffusion coefficient for C28. And in this case, I have two data points. This is the mixture of C28 with water, and this is with the addition of the dodecanol. And this is graphene. So graphene is hydrophobic, so C28 positions close to the wall. So the diffusivity goes a little bit down compared to the bulk. Now, this is region two, so we're in the middle, which means that water diffusion coefficient is very close to the bulk water diffusion coefficient, and so on and so forth. The interesting thing is that we get very consistent representation both from the all atom and the coarse grain representation, which is pretty promising. And then the last question, this is the most recent one. This is something that we're working on, has to do with the introduction of the nanoparticle. So the question was that what will be the effect of adding a nanoparticle in our mixture? And in this case, we added a cobalt nanoparticle. An immediate challenge that we had to address was to develop an appropriate force field for the cobalt interaction with the fluid. And we did this by performing density functional theory in prototype mixtures. So essentially we used cobalt close to different hydrocarbons. This is butane and water, different configurations. And we also used the 4-to-1 mapping. And based on this, we generated different interaction energies as a function of the distance between the cobalt nanoparticle and the butane or water. And we generate data, and based on this, we fitted a molecular mechanics type of model. This is our force field that we generated. And based on this force field, we perform simulation for the cobalt in the C28 water mixture. And this is some representative results. These are very recent results. The cobalt is shown here in the background. This is the green representation, again, in graphene and in graphene oxide confinement. But the important thing out of this calculation was that in all of the cases, in both cases, cobalt was surfaced, was primarily surrounded by water molecules. So both in the case when it was in the in the wax phase and in the water phase, the majority of molecules around the cobalt nanoparticle was water. That was something very interesting. And of course, when we get at this point, one of the questions that always people ask is, how well do you compare to any experimental data available? And when we started this project, there were very little experimental data. Recently, in recent years, there have been some experimental data from the group of Lynn Gladden at Cambridge, where she's using a number of sophisticated techniques, hydrogen NMR spectroscopy, spin lattice relaxation, and so on, in order to characterize dynamic changes in the system and measure some very accurately things like diffusivity. So Lynn Gladden recently published a couple of papers on exactly the same system that we simulated. And her conclusion was that her experimental data were in excellent agreement with observation from simulation of water C28 at the titanium dioxide pore. So, and this is our own simulation. So this is one of the unique cases where you do simulation first and then experiments come and agree with simulations. And we felt very nice about this. So this brings me to conclusions of my talk. What I tried to convince you through this talk was that molecular simulation is a very powerful tool for the design of materials and processes, in most cases using very limited experimental data, if none. When it comes to applications, MOFs are very promising alternatives for separation processes. Also, we look at mixes at confinement, both in MOFs and in nanopores. And of course, we all know that confinement has a significant effect on the physical properties of fluids. Other people have looked, for example, at critical properties that change significantly with confinement. We look at viscosities, densities, diffusion coefficients, and so on. We develop a model for predicting structure and properties of G12 mixtures. And this model that I just briefly showed you work today is used by Shell in their actual G12 process in Qatar. And over the last few years, we have moved to coarse grain simulations. We have identified through this project and other and many other projects that Martini is a very appropriate model to predict properties of alkanes, AQ systems. We did some polymers recently, and we get good agreement with atomistic force fields. And with this, I would like to close. This is a project, this is a number of projects actually that I presented, funded by different sources. Most of all, I would like to thank Professor Tavares and the ATOMS group for giving me the opportunity to be here with you today and share the results of the work done in my groups in Democritus and Texas A&M at Qatar. And with this, Fred, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Okay. Thank you so much, Professor Economou, for being here with us. It's a pleasure to have you here. And we're now open for questions. If you want to ask one, please feel free to enable your microphone or write it down in the chat so we can read it. Our YouTube viewers can also ask questions, of course. So who wants to be the first?
Fano.
All right, I can ask the first question. That's an honor.
Go ahead, Professor.
Great talk. When you do the comparison of the transport properties, diffusivities with the Martini, how do you scale time? In other words, is there a free parameter there in the comparison?
Beautiful. Thano, this is excellent. And if I am allowed, I have here with me today Kostas Papavasiliou, who did all the work. So I will let Kostas respond. Kostas, are you here?
Yes. Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi. Thank you. This is an excellent question.
Sorry, Kostas. Can you open your camera, please?
Oh, yes.
Can hear you.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Sorry. Hello. Hi from Greece.
Nice. Welcome.
Actually, this is a very interesting question, and it comes from the fact that due to the coarse-grained approach, the potential energy surface is flatter, it lacks the detail from the atomistic level. And usually the case here is that people that do simulations with Martini in, say, biological systems have a factor, a scaling factor that they use to give these diffusion coefficients that originates from water, really. It comes, it's around 4. But this is not universal, and you cannot use it for systems, for example, in alcohols or alkanes. So the results that you saw are basically unscaled. We haven't used any scaling compared to atomistic simulations. And the noteworthy thing here is that they are very close in magnitude compared to the atomistic ones. We didn't aim for accuracy when it came to the coarse-grained simulations. We just needed to see if the proper trends are reproduced inside the pore. So we didn't really look into that in more detail. But it is something that is worth exploring in the future in more detail. But in summary, the bottom line is that these are unscaled. There should be some scaling, but we haven't really looked into that in more detail.
Okay, who wants to be the next one? Professor Richard, go ahead.
So I had one serious question, and that is when you're talking about MOFs and these crystalline membranes. So, I guess it's a few related questions. How thick can you make a single crystal of a MOF? And assuming that that membrane that you make is going to be polycrystalline, how do you deal, or how do you anticipate dealing with these multi-crystals that are sort of glommed together at different orientations and with different entrances and exits in different alignments? And how do you make a membrane out of that?
Okay, Richard, good to see you. And it's an excellent question. But as you know, I'm not an experimentalist. So we're collaborating with a group in College Station with Haikon Jong. Haikon is one of the first students of Mike Tsapatsis. So we had always this kind of question and debate. And it's not easy to make this kind of membranes. And usually with Haikon, we have a lot of questions. Clearly, what we simulate is exactly the crystal structure. So you have to be extremely careful when you make these layers of the crystalline layers. And my immediate question is that I don't know how he's doing it. I see Ilya here, and I know that Ilya is working with Mike. So, but I cannot be more explicit on this. I mean,
okay, okay. Yeah. Yeah, well, I guess one thing you could simulate, though, is entrance and exit effects. And so if they are important, I mean, you could simulate those.
Yes, yeah. But the scales that we simulate are very small, in the order of a few nanometers. So we don't look at the, defects in the crystal structure, at the intercrystal diffusivity and so on. So we're looking only at the crystal structure.
Sure, sure. I guess, and then one other, this is not maybe the most serious question, but your slides are amazing. It's compliments to your beautiful slides.
These are compliments for my group, because lots of people from my group are here. So, you know, it's...
Okay, so do you have a secret to that? I mean, are you planning to teach a course in how to make beautiful slides anytime soon? I want to sign somebody up.
Thank you, Richard.
That's all.
I think Raul Fuentes has a question. Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you. Dear Dr. Ioannis, nice talk. I wanted to ask you about
how something is going on.
I think you are in two accounts, so you have to mute the other one.
Yeah.
The sound.
Yes. Let me, yes, I close the other because
yes.
In my desk, because I don't have.
We cannot hear you.
Okay, it's fine now.
Okay.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Dr. Ioannis, nice talk. My question is about the diffusion coefficient. It's interesting that the quantity of the diffusion when it's calculated, no? And as you said, it's difficult for an experimental do the evaluation of these quantities. What do you think? Why is so huge, greater than in the bulk?
Why it's greater than the bulk?
Yes, because the number is and the bulk is almost two or three, depending on the model.
It's not that much greater than the bulk. I believe it's within the statistical uncertainty, and maybe it gets a little bit higher because also there is probably a little bit of a change in the density as well, because also the density may change a little bit, but even a small change in the density may increase the diffusion coefficient. But overall, I would say that when we're far away from the wall, the diffusion coefficient is very close to the bulk.
No, because I saw the picture and I maybe I am wrong.
No, maybe you're wrong. It had to do with water versus C28. When you compare the same thing, the same component, the diffusivity is very similar.
But you showed that in X, Y, the direction, the diffusion is greater than 15, no? And greater than in the bulk.
Yeah. Can you identify the slide so it can help to understand your question? Maybe if you did you make note about the slide? Raul, do you know the slide?
I don't remember. It's when the professor showed the result about the water.
I can share my one second, please. Let me see. So here, for example, I mean
yes, when is the oxide and all atom calculation, the diffusion is greater, no? Than the
no, always the bar here is the bulk, and always you can see here we're very close, always we're slightly under the bulk. We never have a case.
Okay.
Maybe here, but
yes, I saw. Yeah. But in the, I mean, in the region two, is greater, no?
Yes, only here it's a little bit greater. Yes.
And I don't know.
I say here.
Yes, actually, in the atomistic systems, you point out correctly that in the bulk-like region, C28 appears to be slightly more mobile. Well, this has to do with the size of the system in one hand, because we have only used a few alkane chains in there. Most of them are packed on the surface, but not entirely. Their tails are kind of free to move. So you get of sort of have, you know, these wangling ends that are belonging in the central region and gives the effect of increased mobility. You don't have that in the case of the coarse-grained approach. And actually the coarse-grained approach is a bit less sensitive in the structural description of the molecule. It's not designed to cover these fine characteristics, but this is the reason that you see that in the atomistic case.
Okay. Thank you very much for.
Who wants to ask a question next?
I would be happy to ask a question.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Please, go ahead.
Yeah. Ioannis, sorry, I feel a little bit underdressed. I went for a run earlier. Thank you for the great talk. I have a question on the vax. When you have the complex mixture, you are simulating just linear alkanes. Is there a chance that in the experimental system you have semi-crystalline regions where there's local crystallization if you just have linear alkanes?
Yes. I mean, we have looked at very, very many different mixes in the past. We have also looked at other components. We have looked also at some branch hydrocarbons at the early stages of the project. We have looked very many different. I only, provided just a snapshot of things that we have mostly worked. We have looked at various hydrocarbons at different stages of the project. Yes. Okay, and it depends on the system. Depends also on the conditions. I mean, again, the shell process results is slightly different than the Sasol process for the G12 mixture.
Yeah, I was wondering about the density difference between the different models, whether the experiment could include higher density crystalline regions versus the simulations where you likely don't have any semi-crystalline regions.
No, I don't think we have done this comparison. But always, in the majority of the cases, we looked at, I think when we look at diffusivities, we mostly do NVT simulations. We try to get closely to the experimental densities for the particular mixtures.
I think Professor Haja has a question.
Yes. Can I ask?
Yes, of course.
Thank you, Professor.
Haja, can you open your camera, please?
I'm not able to open the video, but I can ask a question.
Go ahead.
Okay.
I think
no.
It's only for me, or
I think he's frozen.
It's frozen. Yeah, it's not only for me. Or I think the when he opened the camera, that might be problem.
I think you can ask your question, Professor, and then we. Oh, I think he's back.
I think it came back.
Okay, nice. Go ahead, Professor Haja.
Sorry about it. I tried to put on the video.
No problem.
Diffusion that generally, in at least macroscopic, is a direction. Some anisotropy is involved. How do you introduce this anisotropy? For example, is it electrostatic interactions you are more concerned, or are there weak hydrogen bond interactions in your case? This is one thing was not clear to me.
This is a very, very interesting question, and I would like in general to point out that we have looked at an isotropy in, of course, we're talking about the XY direction, and we look at an isotropy in many different projects. And because I see here Luis Franco, you know, Luis and I worked together many years ago, Luis has developed a very interesting method to look at an isotropic diffusivity. So, and what he find out is that depending on the interaction between the wall and the gas molecule, electrostatic interactions play a very, very critical role in this kind of diffusivity. So I don't know, Luis, if you want to say something about this.
Hi, Ioannis, good to see you. Thank you for a beautiful presentation. I think you said we find is that for sure for the DZZ compared to DXX and DYY, there is a difference close to the wall. And when you go to the boat, the center of the pore, they become...
Luis, yes. Please, can you speak louder? Because for me, at least, is...
Oh, sorry.
It's not so loud. Thank you.
Is it better?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Thank you. So as I was saying, For sure, for DZZ compared to DXX and DYY, we have a significant anisotropy close to the wall. But we verified that for some surfaces, even the parallel components present some kind of anisotropy. For example, close to calcite. And then Alberto Striolo verified the same thing, even for hydrated fluids close to calcite surface. So yes, we can find this behavior, yes.
The basic question is, for example, in the molecular interaction potential, is the curvature of the potential well is any importance in this? The potential well has a curvature, right? Can you talk of a curvature there? Like Lennard Jones?
Yes, if I can answer something here, we didn't verify
interaction between repulsive and attractive potentials. How do you relate this now? The curvature of that potential well.
Yeah, that's a good question. We didn't verify this differences in the potential energy causing this, but we showed that actually is the arrangement in the crystallographic plane close to the fluid that allows these differences between the parallel components. But for sure, the electrostatic and the van der Waals interactions play an important role. But we didn't study this difference in the. You are saying curvature of the potential energy. I imagine that you are talking about the
Lennard's own potentials are other potential. There's a potential well, right? When the potential positive is negative. The curvature steeper means the more curvature means a relation between attractive interactions and repulsive interactions. Because apparently there seems to be more attractive interactions in your diffusion calculation. Apparently, no. That's why I was wondering. Is it attractiveness is taken more for a two-dimensional system or the fluctuations, you know? I don't know if you want to think in terms of radial distribution function. How about the fluctuation? Are you very near the critical point of the system?
That's another question. What's the critical point in confinement?
Yes.
Hi, do you have more questions?
No, basically I wanted to know the difference between two-dimensional and three-dimensional systems, you know. Here, do you think a two-dimensional description is better than a three-dimensional? That's all, in the quote. That's what I wanted to know.
But our system is in confinement. So, I mean, by definition, we're looking at two dimensions and
oh, it's not in between.
I think it depends on geometry, no?
Yeah.
Because you're talking about the near the wall and in the center of the pore. That's where all this came about. You know,
correct. I don't think that in this project we look at the Z direction for... Luis, I don't remember. Did you look at the Z direction when you had your confined fluids?
Yes. We look at it. Actually, we derived a new method to calculate.
The new method, yes.
Yes, it's in JCTC, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, we look at this, but we didn't do any calculations for different geometries. I mean, for example, for spherical pores or something like this. This would be interesting. Yes, but I think one thing that Professor Haja is mentioning, we could do simulations for hypothetical systems and then play with this potential well, and in this way we could verify what he's talking about. But in our project, we did calculations for force fields that represent some real systems, for example, calcite or silica or quartz. So we didn't play with the potential energy. We used the force field that represents that material. And I think that's the difference.
Yeah, that's okay. Thank you, Warren.
Thank you. Professor Fred, if you have your question.
Yes, I can go, but if somebody wants to make questions, I can
give the time. Does anybody wants to ask a question?
So I go. Ioannis, thank you for the nice presentation, nice slides, as Richard mentioned already. you have shown CO2 methane separations, very nice separation, and so I wonder about nitrogen methane separation. That's much harder to separate nitrogen from methane, because at room temperature they are very similar, and the polarizability of both are very similar. So okay. And also the diameter is about the same. So we expect some diffusivity to be similar, and the polarizability is similar. So the van der Waals interaction with some surface is not different, at least at room temperature.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it's very nice. It's very challenging problem, at least here in Brazil, because we have some reservoir with a lot of nitrogen, and we need to take this separate from natural gas. So, do you suggest an approach about this?
we can look at it. I don't recall, because the majority of our calculation had to do with CO2 mixes and gases, but I can look at it and I can send you. If we have calculations for nitrogen, methane, I can send them to you. Yes, we can certainly look some of these calculations. Absolutely.
Okay. Do you expect, find an example that you can give nice separation but these two gas, because
we
do easily this at low temperature, like cryogenic separation, but it's hard to separate that, especially adsorb preferentially nitrogen that we want to.
Yes. I know what you're talking about. Yes, but I need to look at it.
Thank you. But another point.
Yes.
I don't know, but you show some very strong effect using beryllium. Amazing the order of magnitude in the separation. But do you know the mechanism for that?
Yes, because beryllium is very small. So, you know, it's exactly when the barrier becomes very, very critical. So it's clearly size driven. Yes.
I said size driven. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. What the point?
The problem with beryllium, of course, is very toxic. So
yes, it's very hard to
try to apply for a patent on this, but you know, it was not possible.
Okay, interesting. Maybe you can try to find another substitute for that, but it's not easy. did some DFT calculation, quantum mechanic DFT, to compare your first field to define some parameter for your first field for soil, and you use some structure information like from X-ray or so to see if your structure is consistent or not.
Yes,
but it's very important to measure some vibration, like how your door open, how the vibration of the, because this mechanism is more dominated by vibration than other stuff.
Yeah. We look also at vibrational modes and we're in good agreement.
Okay. So I didn't send that maybe. Okay.
Yeah. No, I didn't show it. I didn't show it, but we had many more checks.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. My next question is about the cobalt nanoparticles that you show. And your simulation shows some not symmetrical results. You have a strong symmetry for your system. So I expect some symmetrical profile due to your symmetry of the system. But you show results without symmetry. Do you think that's it's take time for converge, or you expect already a symmetry from the cobalt size particle nanoparticles?
Good point. Costa, are you still here?
Yes, actually the asymmetry inside the pore has to do with the fact that nanoparticle is practically on the one side. It resembles a grafted nanoparticle. So that's why you have this asymmetry in the partial densities of the components. It doesn't have to do with any symmetry with regards to the particle itself.
I didn't understand, sorry. Because your system is completely symmetrical. So as you showed several results before, so you get a profile, symmetrical profile from your simulation. So I expect something symmetrical, at least in long time scale, you because the symmetry of the system, you know? So yes. I wonder if you are kind of short simulation enough to get this, or you expect a where generate some asymmetry due to your particle. I can understand why, but yeah. Okay.
The asymmetry has to do, first of all, these are long simulations, I think around 200 nanoseconds, but the asymmetry has to do mostly with the fact that the nanoparticle is more attractive towards water. So even though the mixer phase separates inside the pore, the majority of the particle's surface is covered by water. So this causes a slight asymmetry in how the components are distributed inside. I don't know if Yanis has a slide ready to show it once again. Yanis, can you please?
Can you see this? Sorry. Which one?
Yes. So, let's take the case in graphene, for example. If you look on your left, it's where the nanoparticle lies. So basically, you have water in the center, as you would expect. But since water is really drawn towards the nanoparticle, it displaces some of the alkane that would normally take up some portion of the region closer to the surface. So you see, there is even some water very close to the surface that is directly attached to the nanoparticle on your left. This is why you have this.
If you have well, maybe this is kind of size dependent, you know? Because, well, you have symmetry. So you expect some symmetrical behavior. But maybe it's size dependent.
Yes, it could be. I mean, we haven't looked at any other sizes because these are relevant to the process itself. We try to use pore size widths and nanoparticle sizes that are relevant to the actual process. And basically, this is more of an example of what could be done in the future, because this is the first time that molecular simulations are used to describe systems in this context. So in the future, one could go to more complex systems and other nanoparticles. The description of the nanoparticle itself lacks a lot of information. This is a very crude approach, but what is interesting here is that in the future one could use techniques to separate the system in the different areas of resolution. Say, for example, use a coarser description for a bigger system, and then use a more detailed description for the area of interest, say the catalyst surface. Maybe one could couple coarse-grained approaches with atomistic simulations and even, I don't know, quantum mechanics to see reactions on the surface. These are ideas that are tested at the moment, not by our lab, but in other labs around the world, to use hybrid approaches, atomistic and coarse-grained. So ideally, one could use this to try to explain issues with the process in more detail in the future.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I think Professor Richard has a follow-up question. Please go ahead.
Fred asked about the swapping out something for the beryllium. If you look at the periodic table, magnesium is just below beryllium. Why not try that?
Yeah, I think we have tried for magnesium. Yes, you're very correct. We have looked at the periodic table and we have some data for magnesium, and it's very similar to beryllium. Yes.
Oh, but I've played with magnesium personally in a chemistry lab. It's not, I mean, it blows up if you're not careful.
Absolutely. But I mean,
it's not so toxic. So why not do that? Why can't somebody make that ziff?
The answer is yes. You can do it in the lab, but we have done all the calculations, the periodic table at some early stage. Also, we look at magnesium. We have data on this.
So did you file a patent on that then? I mean, it doesn't
No. I think the beryllium was the most appropriate one. I mean, it gave us fascinating results. So magnesium was not that that great.
Oh, okay. What's the size of magnesium relative to beryllium or cobalt?
Richard, I don't know.
I would just think it has
to look at it, yes. Middle. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, well. Okay. So, yeah, I don't know. It'd be nice to see that on the graph, yeah. I guess.
But I agree. But for the beryllium, you know, we look at many different labs. We even contacted some people from Omar Yagi's group, and nobody wants to do experiments with beryllium.
Yeah, I guess I can understand that. Well, thank you.
Okay, any more questions? So I think it's time to wrap it up then. Thank you so much once again, Professor Economou, for this presentation. It was a very nice one.